Thank you. So today I'm going to talk about some serious stuff, and then hopefully we'll have a little bit of humor along with it. I brought some props. I'm going to need some help from some people in the front row to commit a crime. And for the serious part, I'm going to be talking about DNA errors, forensic DNA errors today. So imagine, and I'm only going to ask you to imagine this briefly, a loved one is hurt or killed in a crime. Someone's finally arrested. You go through the endless trials, and someone is incarcerated for the crime. You think you're done with it. 12 years, 20 years later, you hear they got the wrong person. That's the kind of thing that we're trying to avoid. And so in order to do that, we have to constantly be looking at our techniques to see how to improve them. And so I'm going to talk about some issues in my own field that I've seen in my work. I work in all 50 states now. I have cases overseas, Asia, Africa, Europe. And some of the things I've seen that I'm concerned about and that I've raised at professional meetings, some of it's never been shown before, and I'll show you tonight. So we'll be talking about forensic DNA errors. I don't want you to think it's all bad. It's not all bad. It's a great field. It's my life. And I'm going to break it into two categories. One is statistical and interpretive errors, so things where the conclusions are wrong based on human reasoning and mathematics. And the other one is contamination, which is kind of easy to understand. Somebody spills some DNA or it gets transferred. And then I'll tell you what my lab here in Boise is working on in the contamination area very briefly. So we'll have a first slide. I'm going to turn you into DNA experts. Get ready for science. Here it goes. This is the easy stuff. This is a single source. I can teach you guys to do this immediately. Let's say I decide I'm going to commit a crime with this. It's clean. It just got out of the dishwasher, and there was bleach in the dishwasher, so it has no DNA on it. I touch it, and I go to the front row, and I commit a murder. Okay, the police come. They do the spatter. They collect some of the blood to identify the victim. They see my fingerprint, and I always carry a swab. They take, I really do always carry. They take a swab. They swab it, and what's really nifty about these swabs is you can just knock the ends off of them, but I'm going to pull it and put it in here. I should be wearing gloves, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Now, the issue is, am I the murderer, right? So here am I, the suspect, and all you have to know about DNA is you get it from your mother and your father, okay? So that means that every location on the DNA that I'm going to look at, and I've shown you these are four locations here in the columns. Sorry that this is a little off. At every location, you got one number from mom, one number from dad. I got one number from my mom, one from dad. I'm the suspect. Am I a match? Am I a match? Yes. So my students, when I say the word match, they have to say statistics. So am I a match?
Statistics.
At this level, it's probably 10, 100, maybe 1 in 10,000 people would be included in this match. Maybe 1 in, I don't know, 2,000, something like that. All right. That's a single source. Everybody gets it right. Next. Here's a mixture. How do we get a mixture? Before I commit the crime, a couple other people I offer to touch this. Maybe three of you. And so now they come in and they do the swab and they get a mixture. And this is what they get. These, again, are four locations of DNA. But now there's a bunch of what we call alleles or sizes in there. The question becomes, am I included in that? So am I still included? Are all of my sizes in there?
Yes.
Is it a match?
No.
Yes. The statistic is now something like 1 in 10 or maybe 1 in 50. And that's because more people could potentially be included. Now, you'd think that this would be an easy concept, and we'd have mathematics that could deal with it. But when laboratories are given the same data, they sometimes vary in that statistic over 10 to the 10. That's the difference between saying going to court and saying there was $30 of damage to my car, and the damage to my car was greater than the combined gross domestic product of every country over the last 100 years and then some. Okay? So the statistics are done differently in different labs, and they give a very different impression based on how the statistics were performed. This mixture question becomes very complicated, and if you give a mixture to 10 experts, you might get 10 different interpretations. I did that. I took a mixture case from Kerry Robinson, a man who wrote to me who says he's innocent, and he was convicted in a gang rape in Georgia. There were three men who raped a woman. One man's identified, all of his DNA's in the semen recovered from the victim. She picked him out of a yearbook. He's given an option to reduce his sentence. Tell us who one of the other guys is. He makes up a name. The guy doesn't exist. They say no deal. Then he says Kerry, and he can't remember the last name, Robinson, he finally says. And so they arrest Kerry Robinson, a guy he knew in high school. Kerry says he only gave my name because he thinks I talked to the cops about him. But because he gave a name, his sentence is reduced. That man, the first man, is out of prison right now. Kerry Robinson's in prison. I looked at the DNA. I say Kerry Robinson is excluded from that mixture. I took the same data, me and Itiel Dror, my co-author, and we gave it to 17 analysts at the same lab, who all work in one lab, but not the first lab that did the DNA. And we asked them, is it a match? Is he excluded? You didn't say statistic. Is it a match? All right, you got to pass. Is it a match? Is he excluded? Thank you. Or is it inconclusive? We gave it to 17 experts, all trained in one lab in North America, all part of a state lab. We got all three answers. Not only did we get all three answers, but only one of the people at that lab of the 17 agreed with the lab in Georgia's original conclusion that Kerry was included. Next. We got a little attention for that, new scientists picked it up, and economists picked it up, but it's still a problem. All right. I was trying to explain this mixture question to a prosecutor over the summer, and so I had to use some Scrabble tiles. And what I said is a mixture is like if you put my name and your name, Mr. Prosecutor, in a bowl, we put two people in, but you can pull lots out. And so I had to do that. I took our two names, and these are the letters for our two names. And now we'll get into this question of subjectivity and bias, right? Who contributed names to this? Well, I've told you I did. You might not know how to spell my name. But Al Gore did too, didn't he? George Will, Larry King, Mary Kay, Porky Pig, Ann Klein, Henry Miller, Happy Gilmore, Lena Horne, Papa Gino, Pepe Le Pew, Marilyn Monroe, Willy Wonka, Rain Man, King Philip, King Lear, etc. King Kong. The point is, these mixtures, even though we go to court and they say, is the person a match, the statistics can widely vary to the point where they can become meaningless. And there's no uniformity in my field for that. Next slide. This is just some of the attention we got for that article, and I'll take the next one. Okay. Here's another problem of statistics. This is a very unfortunate case. Mr. Denman became a missing person. This is from the Albuquerque newspaper. This is his obituary. He was 49 years old when he left us, and donations can be sent, etc. There was another article about this later when they interviewed his brother because they found the bones near the house and they thought it was a murder. FBI came in, identified. It is Donnie Denman. With DNA, they identified it. And so there's another article looking for people who could help solve the murder. Next slide. This is now 4 months later. Donnie's not dead. His friend was putting newspaper down to repair his car in the garage, saw that there's an obituary for Donnie Denman and that there was a funeral, called Donnie Denman and said, they think you're dead. And he said, who gave the oration? He said, your pastor. He called the pastor. They straightened it out. This shows you that even though there was a DNA match, right, an FBI DNA match, people, even though there's a match statistic. The statistic wasn't that high. This is mitochondrial DNA. It's a particular type of DNA we use on old bones, broken hair, etc. And it doesn't give us those powerful statistics. Next slide, please. This is our last story of statistics. This was my first case in Taiwan. This is for the Taiwan Innocence Project. They'd heard from a man named Mr. Chen. And so I'm going to show you how to read this. This is now Y chromosome DNA. So most of the columns will have just one number. This, I'm sorry that you can't see it that clearly, but this is DNA recovered from semen from the underwear of a rape victim. She was raped by three men. And these are the alleles or DNA sizes that were found. This is Mr. Chen. Now, is Mr. Chen's 15 there? Yes. The 12, in fact, every one of Mr. Chen's alleles are there. Mr. Chen's arrested. Mr. Chen's convicted. He loses all three appeals. He writes to the Taiwan Innocence Project. They meet me when they came over to the States, show me this data, and they say, what can we do? What's the statistic on this? And we tried to calculate a statistic. It was pretty strong. And I said, but there are new tests. And so they went to court in Taiwan, and they got a test that instead of looking at the number of alleles in the first kit, they added some other alleles, some other markers in this kit to look at. So they looked at more locations, more powerful statistics, even though he was included with the less powerful statistics, with the more powerful, here's Mr. Chen, his 17 is not in the underwear, his 13 is not in the underwear. Next slide. This is Mr. Chen in March of 2014. So it's a statistical problem. It was a match. And now we have a better kit that looks at more sites and so gives us more powerful statistics. Okay, now we're going to talk about contamination. Next slide. This is a Los Angeles case. Now, you hear about the test tubes all the time that people who work in labs like I do work with, but you might not know that these are the size we work with now. Okay, they all look the same. There's writing on them. You can't see it, right? Even if you're working on it, you can't. And so the position of the tubes is what's important. Okay, and now I'm going to teach you the principle that I try to teach my people in lab. Do not keep your arsenic in an old spice bottle. Okay? And if you do, don't put the arsenic in the spice rack. Okay? And so when you're handling a suspect's DNA and DNA from a crime scene, you have to do the crime scene DNA first, get it all the way to paper. You're completely done with it before you take out the tube of the suspect's DNA. Why? Contamination, or you just might mix up a tube. Does that ever happen? Well, by the way a lot of experts testify, they can't possibly make a mistake. They're always keeping track of everything. I just heard this story in Montana a couple of weeks ago by an analyst. And here's the, can we go back one slide? Maybe not. What I was showing you is from a Las Vegas case. They're apologizing. Why? What happened? They had two suspects' DNA in line. Somebody accidentally swapped the tubes in the lab. It happens. They told the wrong man, your DNA's a match. You're going to prison for 30 years if we try you. Maybe if you plead guilty, you'll do 7, 10, I don't know. He pled guilty. What would you do, right? You're going against DNA. And then they realized there was a mistake because another lab got the same DNA result and told them you made a mistake, and so they let the man go. They apologize. Okay, next. This is a horrible crime, 1968. 13-year-old girl is murdered, raped and murdered in New Jersey. And in 2004, a cold case unit works on the case. They have underwear from the poor girl. They get some DNA from it, male DNA. They get a profile, matches to a convicted offender. It's got to be guilty, right? A convicted offender. I read about it in the New York Times. I'm like, hooray, DNA's done it. Then they say, oh, shoot, we had this guy, Jerry Bellamy's DNA, in the lab at the same time as the underwear, same day. Maybe it was contamination. I thought, oh, my gosh, this guy's going to get off. The poor sisters of Jane Durrua have been pushing for this for years to get this conviction to find out who killed their sister. Next slide. Turns out it was contamination because they took other clothing from the murder that had never been to the lab, sent it to a lab where none of these guys' DNA had been, got a match to another convicted offender who everyone believed did it, but that convicted offender died before he could go to trial. Okay, so that's another contamination issue, this time in a laboratory between evidence. Next. This is one of my cases in Georgia. Carlton Gary is one of the longest serving death row prisoners in Georgia. He wrote to us saying he was innocent, wrote to a lawyer saying he was innocent who contacted me. I got to work on the case. And working with the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, we looked through all the old evidence. He was convicted of being the Columbus Stocking Strangler, a man who killed a bunch of older women, raped and killed a bunch of older women in the 70s in Columbus, Georgia. And we got some of the clothing from the women. We found biological stains on the clothing. We tested it. The GBI, Georgia Bureau of Investigation, tested it. And they got a DNA profile, not Carlton Gary. We were very excited. Put it in the FBI database, national database. Nothing happened. We waited 2 years. Somebody commits a crime in Georgia with a gun that matches the DNA that doesn't match Carlton Gary. I said it several times. I don't remember. So I don't remember the statistic, but it's convincing. And it's definitely a match. So there's two crimes in Georgia, the rape murders from 77, the gun from a crime just 2 years ago. They match. They're going, God, just leave it. They go after the guy. They find him, the guy with the gun. It can't possibly be the guy who committed these rapes. He's not the right age, etc. They start researching, and what they find out is that it was a contamination in the lab on both of these pieces of evidence with the same DNA that's in the laboratory. That there's no way I can find an explanation for this, because that sample of DNA that contaminated them is a semen sample produced by someone who works in the lab as a quality control. Imagine your job, if your job is producing... I'm not saying you should do this at work, by the way. Don't come to me if you do. In any case, So this remarkably rare, supposedly almost impossible thing in a carefully controlled laboratory to have contamination happened twice in this case that I'm working on. It does happen. It is a worry. Next. This is the Phantom of Heidelbronn. My mom lived in Europe for most of her life, and I'd go and visit her, and we'd heard about the Phantom. This is a woman who is involved in six murders, another mysterious death. She's found in syringes that heroin users discard on beaches. She's found all over Europe committing crimes. They don't know who she is. They sample all these women in Heidelbronn, you know, hundreds of women in Heidelbronn, no match. They can't decide what it is. Thank you. It was all the same DNA. It was all 100% matched to the DNA of this woman. Thank you. Good, you're good. Oh, can we stop the game? Can we stop now? You get an A, but now stop. So what happens is they go through all of this, and they you know, this is a huge Interpol case. 15 years, and what is it? A lady who works in the swab factory took some work home, right? She got contaminated on the swab. She's never committed a crime in her life. Now, why wasn't that detected in 15 years? People use swabs in lab for controls. If there was a central agency looking at unexpected results, looking at our contamination results, they could put this together quickly. The truth is, labs don't talk about their errors. You have to subpoena that information. You have to force them to disclose that information. It's not the way science should be. Science should be looking for its errors and publicly disclosing them, because it's good science, but there's problems. The best way to find problems is be open about them. Next. So what is my lab doing about it? Well, this is an idea we came up with years ago, that we would use DNA sequences that don't exist in nature. So I've discovered them. We call them nullomers, the smallest sequences of DNA that don't exist in nature. It was a cool little idea, kind of a party trick. And now we've made markers out of them, and we've strung them together. And so this is the marker. So if you have to give a sample to the police, say, see this band here? That's my nullomer marker. This is a DNA profile. Those numbers that we've been looking at come off of these charts, but our marker shows up glowing. So if you give a sample and the marker's in it, it's right there. And even if we dilute your DNA, we put it in water so that it's only one part per million of that original sample, and dilute it there, that marker's still there, even though your DNA has been diluted out and not detectable. So those are our nullomer markers. It's our contribution. Last slide. This is Michael Hash. I worked on his case for many years. DNA did not free him. There was nothing we could find, but great lawyering did. So thank you very much for your attention.